this man, Pastor Paul, Medu Kumbusha. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We give you glory. Let's just go before God, every one of us. Just tell God, thank you for this day. It is another day that God has given us. Father, we give you glory. We bless you. We say thank you, Almighty Jehovah God. We thank you for this opportunity you have given us, oh God, to be in your presence, Almighty Jehovah, my Father. We give you the glory, Lord. We bless you, Father. We thank you. We worship you because you are worthy, oh God. Be exalted and be lifted in the name of Jesus. We thank you because you are worthy. We thank you because of the victories you have given us. Lord, we give you glory. Randobo sikalabayantolo losaya. Balalabo sikalabayantolo losikalabakato. Leti basando lobo sikalabakandolo losatalabose. Rebe sando lobo sikalabayantolo losaya. Lord, we bless you, my Father God. We thank you because you are worthy, oh God. We worship you, my Father. We give you the glory, Lord. We bless you because you are worthy, God. Be exalted and be lifted. We thank you, Father God. We bless your holy name. Randobo sikalabayantolo dosaya. Balalabo sikalabarandolo dosi. Latiba sendere de sikalabakatolo dosi. Rende bokotala la sikalabayando. Rekebe sandolo bosikalabakaya. Balalabo sikibakura bakotolo dosi. Father, we bless you. We thank you, Jesus. We give you the glory. We bless you, Lord. We surrender ourselves before you. Receive all the honor and the praise. Receive all the praises, oh God. Receive all the adoration. Lord, we exalt your holy name, oh God. We give you the glory. We bless you because you are worthy. The things that you have done unto us, they are worthy of their praise. Worthy to be exalted. Worthy to be given all the honor. We thank you because Jehovah God, you have been there for us. You have protected us. You have covered us, oh God, from every form of complication. Lord, you have protected us, oh God. When the enemy came like a flood, my Father, you raised up a standard in the mighty name of Jesus. That's why we pray and give you the glory. We bless you, my Father. We thank you, Jehovah God. Randobo sikalabo saya. Balalabo sikalabakato. Letiba sendelebese. Rekebesato. Rebebesa. Lokoto koto. Yenebese. Rebeso. Lekete. Yenebe. Lokoto. Nebebesindo. Orobo sando lobo saya. We give you the praise. We bless you, my Father. We thank you because you are worthy. We give you the glory. We bless you because you are Jehovah God. Be exalted, my Father God. Be lifted, my Father. Rendebo sekere Messiah. Belebe sando lobose. Rekebe antolobosi kalabose. Rekepe kantololosa. Father, we give you the praise. We bless you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity you have given us. We stand before you, God. We declare that you are worthy. We declare that you are able, oh God. You are able to do more exceedingly, abundantly, above all that which we ask or imagine, according to the mighty power that is at work in us, oh God. We decree today, my Father, have your way in our service, have your way in this place. Heal the sick, my Father. Heal the brokenhearted. Give them direction. Give them, my Father God, the opportunity to stand up again, to testify of your greatness. In the mighty name of Jesus, I break every force, I break every evil. Lord, we give you the glory. We bless you, my Father. We thank you, Jesus. Be exalted and be lifted in the name of Jesus. We pray that every word that we're going to speak today, let somebody, my Father, receive courage. Let somebody be strengthened. Let somebody, my Father, see direction. Let somebody, my Father, God, her eyes, my Father, be opened. Let them, my Father, God, receive what you have kept for them, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus, I lift up my hand, oh God, unto you, my Father. We give you the praise. Rando bosi kalabosi, belele besando lobosaya, nati bosi kele beyando, ikabayando, belebesi, lekete, yene bosa, lokote lebesi, belele besando, leti bosi, lekete, yekete kele besa. We give you glory. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you, we give you glory. We worship you because of your goodness. We pray that, Lord, my Father, you'll be with us today. We pray as we share your word of God, we pray that, Lord, let your spirit be manifested in this place in a way that you have never seen before. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Someone say amen. Let's all say amen. Maybe you can close the windows so that we can close the windows so that we avoid external noises. Okay, we may sit, we may have our seat and sit on it. Father, today, do you have a song? All right. I want to take this opportunity to welcome us in this service. First of all, we must say that the Lord is good. God is good and all the time. Let's say again, God is good and all the time. That is his nature. Amen. Yes, God has been good to us. He has protected us. He has preserved us. That is why we must be able to say that he's a good God. He has protected us. He has always been there for us. In all the things that have been happening, we have seen the faithfulness of God. Amen. Not that because we are good, but because he is a good God to us. Amen. Don't forget that whatever God does, he doesn't do it because you are good. He does it because he's a good God. And when he does it because he's a good God, it's because he wants to demonstrate his goodness unto us. The Bible says in Psalms chapter 23 that his goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. Can I hear you say amen? So we must appreciate the goodness of the Lord. The goodness of the Lord, we must appreciate it all the time. No matter what you might be going through, no matter what is happening in your life, you must appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Somebody confess with me. Say again, I will appreciate. Sema kwa nguvu, I will appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Let's say it again, I will appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Yes, we must appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Amen. So today we are going to continue with our subject of what we have been learning for the last 3 weeks about the dreamers. And every Sunday, I've been giving you 7 points about the dreamers. Somebody say amen. So today we are going to go to part 4 of the dreamers. Because every one of us, you are a dreamer. Somebody say, I am a dreamer. Yesterday, I got opportunity to be on radio. And I was recording 28 episodes about the dreamers. And I was preaching in our dialect. I was preaching in our dialect every episode, 28. When I left the studio, I was very tired, but I was very glad that I was able to reach out to my people. And the episodes are going to run every day for 28 days. That is 14 nights and 14 days on our local radio station. So we are going to learn today about the dreamers. And we are reading from the book of Genesis, chapter number 37. Favor, Jose, Paul, you can get Genesis chapter number 37. And those who are watching us online, we are reading the book of Genesis chapter number 37. And please, as we continue, tell us, we might be just entertaining you when you cannot be able to hear us clear. Tell us if the voice is clear. Tell us if the sound is clear. Tell us if the light is clear. Wherever you are watching, just comment. Just tell us if the light is clear, if the sound is clear, if you can be able to hear us very clearly. And also, we'd like to know where you are listening and watching us from. Please let us know. Just tell us, I am watching from this place, and the sound is clear, the voice is clear, and the light is clear. Yes, we have got several people online, and your response to us will be able to encourage us so that we can try to improve on what we are doing. So just tell us if we are clear. Are we clear? Is our light clear? Is our sound clear? God bless you. In Genesis chapter number 37, the Bible says, now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, and in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was the son, was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. Verse number 3. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. Also, he made him a tunic of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully to him. So, which means that it was because the favor that Joseph had acquired from his father that made the brothers to hate him. You need to understand that sometimes when people hate you, they do not hate you because of who you are. They hate you because of the favor of God that is upon you. Sometimes people see what you don't see. And if you don't take serious what you don't see, people will always try to fight it, thinking that it is you who they are fighting, when in the real sense, they are fighting what is in the inside of you. So the Bible says that Israel loved Joseph more than all his brethren. And when he loved him, the Bible says in verse number 5 that Joseph had a dream. And he told it to his brothers, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even the more. So which means that it is the dream that he carried that brought more complications upon him. And that is why you need to understand that if God has given you something, that thing will always make you look controversial among those who are common people. Somebody say amen. If God has given you something that is special than what other people have, that thing will always make you look controversial than those who are around you. And that is why you need to protect your heart. You need to protect your mind. You need to protect everything that you have, because you don't know who comes into your life, what they have seen in the inside of you. The Bible says that they hated him even the more. The first hate was that one, that they hated him because the father loved him. The second hate was that one, they hated him because he had a dream. People that have got nothing, they have got no opposition. People that have got nothing, nobody will try to compete with them. People that have got nothing, nobody will try to fight against them. People that have got nothing, nobody will try to rise against them. That's why in most instances you have seen, nobody goes to the house of a poor person to steal. Nobody goes to a place whereby there is a beggar on the street and tries to fight him. But they will always go where there is something. So you need to understand that anytime you face any kind of opposition, that opposition is a sign that God has given you a position, or God has put you in a particular position that is not the same as those who are around you. Can I hear you say amen? If there is any opposition that you are facing, it is a sign that you have a position in the spiritual realm. The Bible says that Jesus has seated us with Jesus. We are seated with Christ Jesus in the heavenly places. So which means that there is a particular position that we have in Christ, that every time you walk, you are not just a common person. Then number two, you need to understand that you are a stranger. Joseph was a stranger because his father was a stranger. And the Bible says that his father dwelt in the land where he was a stranger. When I said, praise the Lord. We need to understand that we are strangers. We are strangers on this world. The Bible says in John chapter number 17, the Bible says that you are of the world, but you are in the world, but you are not of the world. You need to live as if you don't belong to that place. Don't live as if you belong to your friends. Don't live as if you belong to the people around you. Don't live as if you belong to your schoolmates. But live as if you are just there for a temporal season. Somebody say amen. People who are temporal in a place, they don't build houses in that place. Can I say that one again? People who are temporal in a place, they don't build permanent houses. They build tents. Praise God. In your life, don't build tents. Sometimes even friends that come around you, don't build houses on them. Build tents. Why? Because you are a sojourner. You are moving from one dimension to another. You are moving from one place to another. Some of you will agree with me. The people that you are with in primary school are not the same people that you are with in high school. The people you are with in high school are not the people that you are with when you are not in high school. And the people that you are with when you are not in high school are not the same people that you are with when you are in work. Praise God. Because if somebody does not add value unto you, there is no reason to build a permanent structure on them. Be a kind of a person that is always a stranger. Any place that you go, don't build a permanent structure. Praise God. Be always on the move. Somebody say, I'm on the move. Shout again, I'm on the move. You must always be on the move. Don't live with the friends that you grew with. Let's say, for example, because we are in Nairobi, the friends that you met in Dandora or Kariobangi, or the friends that you met with in that slum, are the ones that you are walking with in the place that you are going. Because if you build a permanent structure on such a kind of friends, they are going to pull you in a slum mentality. Praise God. So there are people that you meet in your life, you walk with them, you leave them at a particular stage, you take others. If you want to grow, there are people never build a permanent structure on them. Somebody say amen. I want to give you the seven points about being a dreamer. Number one, you must connect to the Father's blessings. You must connect to the Father's blessing. The Bible says, Joseph brought a bad report of them to his fathers. So the first thing, in order for your dream to become a reality, you must connect to the Father's blessings. The Bible says that children obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. This is the first commandment with a promise. Honor your father and mother. So you must be able to connect to your father's blessing. And how do you connect to the father's blessings? You need to understand that the blessing in your life is as strong as the blessing over your life. Your prophetic life or your prophetic coverage determines your destiny coverage. That is why everybody of us, there is always a cover that is upon us. If a son or a daughter disconnects herself from a father, you find that you have exposed yourself to the attack of the enemy. You have exposed yourself to destruction. And that is why children who disobey their parents, they don't go far. Children who insult their parents, they don't go far. Children who fight against their parents, they don't go far. No matter how old you are, they must be a cover that you need. No matter how old you are, you need somebody like a father figure in your life. Somebody that can be able to guide you through. And that is why to go further in your life or in your chosen pursuit, you need a father. Your father is your feathers, assisting you to fly into your future to the top. Your father is your feathers that will assist you to fly to the top of your pursuit. And that is why the Bible says that Isaac blessed both Esau and Jacob. In Genesis chapter number 26, verse number 13 to 14, let's read that one very quickly. The Bible says, then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. For he had possessions of flocks, possessions of herds, and a great number of servants. So the Philistines, they envied him. When you look in Genesis chapter 25, verse number 5 and 6, the Bible says, and Abram gave all that he had to Isaac, but Abram gave gift to the sons of the concubine, which means that Abram blessed his own son Isaac. He gave all that he had, but to the rest, he gave him the gifts. Somebody say amen. So in Genesis chapter 27, verse number 28 and 29, we find that also Isaac blessed Esau and Jacob. In 28, the Bible says, and therefore he may God give you of the dew of heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of the grain and wine. Let people serve you, and nations bow to you. Be master over your brethren, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. And when we also look into verse 40, also, then Isaac his father answered and said to Esau, behold, your dwelling shall be of the fatness of the earth. So which means that a father has got a responsibility to speak a blessing over his children. Praise the Lord. And that is why if your father has never blessed you, today I prophesy, may this blessing of a father begin to flow over your life in the mighty name of Jesus. Somebody say amen. In Exodus chapter number 33, not Exodus, but Deuteronomy chapter number 33, verse number 6, the Bible says, and Moses said, let Reuben live and not die, nor let his men just become few. Why? Because Jacob had cursed Reuben. But when Moses came into the picture, Moses reversed the curse that was upon Reuben and said, let Reuben live. And that is why you need to understand, if your spiritual, if you have got your spiritual father, a man that stands in authority, a man stands in a higher authority, he can reverse a curse that your father has put upon you, and that blessing can begin to operate upon you. They are people, their fathers have spoken bad things about them. There are people that they don't greet each other. There are people they don't talk to their biological parents. There are people they don't even look eye to eye to their spiritual, to their physical parents. I came to let you know, if you find yourself in a such a situation, you need the blessing of a father. And if that man cannot be able to reconcile with you, if your father cannot be able to reconcile, if your mother cannot be able to reconcile, you need a man of God that is in authority. And this man, when he speaks a word over your life, that curse can be reversed and you can begin to walk in freedom. The Bible says that let Reuben live and not die. And that is why when you speak a blessing of a father has to bless you. Do this if you have not, and identify who your father is. Identify who your pastor is, because not every prophet is your prophet. You might have mentors. You might have people to guide you. You might have role models. But the truth of the matter is, when it comes to your pastor, a pastor is a man or a woman that God has given a responsibility over your soul. And that is why in the book of Acts chapter number 20, verse number 28, the Bible says that we must take heed to the flock which the Holy Spirit has made an overseer over, which means that a pastor is one that becomes accountable, and this one is like a father unto you. And that is why when you connect your father's blessing, you connect by sowing. So, and that is why another thing you can do to connect to the blessing of a father or a mentor or a prophet is to sow into the anointing in his life. Isaac asked Esau to bring him the venison he loved so that he can be able to bless them. You have to sow into the life of your mentor. You have to sow it spiritually. You have to sow materially. You have to sow mentally. And that is why Saul said, what do we bring to the prophet? In 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse number 7. They brought it unto the prophet, and the prophet was able to give him direction by commanding him or by ordaining him to become a king. Number two, you have to be a fighter. You cannot see your dream becoming a reality if you don't fight. Life doesn't give us what we wait for. Life gives you what you fight for. For Esau to experience the blessings of God, one of the things that Isaac told Esau in Genesis chapter number 27, verse number 40, he said unto him, by your sword you shall live, and you shall serve your brother. It shall come to pass when you become restless that you shall break the yoke from your neck. There are things that can never come into your life until you become restless. That's why you find, for example, in the U.S., whereby a police officer killed a black man, and there was a riot, and there is still riot everywhere. The reason why people have to liberate themselves from racism and slavery is when the big people become restless. Anytime you see restless in a place, that is a sign of liberation. People cannot be liberated until the time they become restless over something. You have to become restless over poverty. You have to become restless over racism. You have to become restless over xenophobia. You have to become restless over begging. There are things that until you become restless, you can never access them. Until you become restless from people assisting you with their dress, you can never have freedom. The Bible says that he was told that the day you become restless, you will break your brother's yoke from your neck. I'm talking to somebody today that may the Lord give you a spirit of restlessness, that the thing that has been oppressing you, may you begin to oppress it in the name of Jesus. Because the day you become restless, you break the yoke. You break the yoke. So the day you become restless, you must become a fighter. In Genesis First Samuel chapter number 17, the Bible shows when David went to see Saul. Chapter 17, verse number 57 to 58, the Bible says that, and when David had come from battle with the Philistine, he went to see Saul. And Joab took him. And when he took him, the Bible says that David was carrying the head of Goliath. And when Saul saw the head of Goliath, he asked, 57, he said, then as David returned from the slaughter, of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, whose son are you, young man? So David answered, I am the son of your servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite. He did not come before Saul empty. That is why when you come in the presence of greatness, don't come with empty words, but come with something that a king can know that you are a potential fighter. Something that will expose your potential. Something that will show your ability. And that is why every time David went before the king, he did not come before the king empty-handed. He had something. He either had a harp, he either had a sword, he either had the head of the Goliath. Why? What you know best is what will take you before the princes and before the kings. And that is why it is very important when you go before the presence of the greatness, don't go there to impress them. Don't go there with a lot of talk. Let your actions speak for you. Let who you are begin to market you. Let the potential that is in you begin to speak for you. If you have got a talent, begin to manifest your talent. If you have got a gift, begin to manifest your gift. If you have got a gift of singing, begin to sing. Because it is your gift that will speak for you, not your theory. The reason why most of us have lost the most opportunities is because when we sit before great people, we want to impress them. We want to tell them the things we have done. We want to tell them where we have gone. We want to tell them what we have. No, get yourself with the head of Goliath so that when the king sees that you can do what he has never done, opportunity becomes open. In fact, you need to understand, when you go to any great company, they don't want your theory and qualifications. They want your experience. They want your confidence. They want your ability to deliver. They want to see that this work can be done. If you can show a CEO that it can be done, you will get a job. Not for them to favor you. Not for them to do as they wish. No, don't go in the presence of a king with a mentality of a beggar. So, if you do not like the level where you are, you do not fly from there. You fight from there. If you want to get from where you are, you have to fight. And that is why if you have made up your mind to get to the top of your dream, then you have made up your mind to be a fighter. Abner brought David before Saul. And that is why when David came before Saul, David was holding the head of the Goliath. And that's why you need to understand that you are a fighter. All of us are fighters. Somebody say, I'm a fighter. Shout again, I'm a fighter. I can't hear you. Say again, I'm a fighter. You need to understand that they say that biologically that before you are born, there were 99.99 seeds of a man that fought, but you came out a conqueror. And that is why you need to understand that before you were born, you started fighting battles. Somebody say amen. So don't let any earthly battle defeat you, because you fought 99.99 million people and you defeated them and you came out. And because you came out and you came out victoriously, other battles that are before you, God will enable you to win them. Can I hear you say amen? Life is a fight. To sit down in one place and be lamenting, looking for who will pit you or sympathize you, will bury you in the same pit. Don't sit there and look for him to complain. And that is why you must wake up and fight. Somebody say, I'm waking up and I will fight. Shout again, I'm waking up and I will fight. When I came out of school, I dropped out in class 8, but I refused class 8 to be my reason of complaining every day. That is why you need to understand that if I am your parent, if I'm your father, and there are things that I cannot do for you, and you know what is best for yourself, push yourself through. Somebody say, I'm going to push myself. Because you cannot sit there, everything to be done to you. Hello? I met another young man recently. This guy, he works with one of the biggest car companies in this country. I asked him, how did you get there? He told me, I dropped out in Form 2. But when I came into the city, I was selling water. He sold water. He took himself to school by selling water. He finished Form 4 by selling water. He got now a small business where he started selling some sweets and some biscuits and some soap. Then now he took himself to university. He finished, he graduated. From nowhere, he got his degree. From nowhere, he got his master's. From nowhere, the young man is working as a manager in one of the biggest companies. Nothing will ever come your way just because you are seated there and saying, it is my guardian's responsibility, it is my father's responsibility. If your father helps you to take you to school, thank God. But don't feel that it is your entitlement to be taken. You must find yourself out. Somebody say amen. Amen. David had to fight. He did not wait for Jesse to come and save him from the bear. He did not wait for Jesse to come and save him from the lions. He did not wait for his brother who is working in the army of Saul to come and fight for him. He said that whether they are there, I know my father is a shepherd. I know my father has kept the sheep. And in one or another, my father has fought the bear. But this time around, these bears are not for my father. This lion is not my father. I will exercise my talent. I will exercise my gift so that I can be able to fight it, and if I can kill it, I will not depend on the experience of my brother who is in the army of Saul, but I'm going to fight it myself. That is why when David got into the army of Saul, the brother told him, what have you come to do here? But David refused to be silent. Let me tell you today, refuse anything to silence you. Whatever that wants to silence you, refuse it in the name of Jesus. Whether be your background, whether be where you are coming from, whether be where you are living from, refuse anything to silence you. Today I come to declare, I refuse to be silent by the economy. I refuse to be silent by where I'm coming from. I'm going to rise up and fight this giant. Amen. Hallelujah. You must rise. Somebody say, I'm rising. Somebody say, I'm rising. David had to rise. And that is why you must reach to a place. You must refuse to be silenced. You must refuse to be silenced. You must refuse to sit down. You must reach to a place whereby you have to stand up to be seen. You have to speak loud so that you can be heard. Because what you need to understand is this. The devil wants to shut up your voice, because he knows that if you cannot speak, then that one is a destiny that is destroyed. But I came to speak to
somebody that the devil is a liar. He cannot silence you. You are rising up in this season. You will speak loud so that you can be heard. You will stand up so that you can be seen. I came to speak to the church of Jesus Christ that you are rising up again. Whatever tried to silence the church, miracles are coming back. Healings are coming back. Deliverances are coming back. The church cannot be put under, but the church will be above all the time, because it is your season to stand up to be seen. Speak loud so that you can be heard and be outstanding against the standing. Hallelujah. So you must fight. Somebody say, I must fight. Say again, I must fight. Oh, I must fight. You must fight. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 to 8, he says that I have fought a good fight of faith. I have kept the faith. I have fought a good fight of faith. You must fight. Somebody say, I must fight. You must fight. And that is why there are some limitations that are inside you that want to pull you down. You must fight them. Any limitation that is trying to push you backwards, you must fight it. Somebody say, I must fight. Confess with me. I can't hear you. You are too quiet. Somebody say, I must fight. Those limitations that want to bring you down, maybe it's something that is coming from your past. Maybe something that happened in your family. Maybe something that always happens repeatedly. Anytime you want to go forward, it comes back again. You must fight against it. Fight against any limitation. Fight. And that is why when you are tired against poverty, prosperity comes. When you are tired of bondage, liberty comes. And when you are tired of where you are, prosperity comes. In Luke chapter number 15, verse number 15 to 18, the Bible shows the prodigal son. It is not his name, but because of the life he was living. But he said, how many servants are in my father's house? I am ready to return. And he said that I will not let shame to put me down. I will not let shame to cause me to be buried. I will not let pride to cause me to die in this place. And he rose up and went back to his father's house. No matter how far you are, fight with yourself and return. Somebody say amen. The seven lepers in 2 Kings chapter 7, 3, 4, the Bible says, they say to one another, why sit we here till we die? Praise God. And they had options. They said, if we go back, Paul, where we came from, we will do what? We will die. If we stay here also, we will do what? We will die. So they said, where we came from, we are not going back. There comes a time whereby no matter what you are passing through, don't go back where you came from. Hallelujah. Myself like this, you know, I always tell you my story. I pushed mkokoteni. I smoked weed. I took drugs. No matter what I go through, I cannot go back to mkokoteni. I cannot go back to drugs. I cannot go back to crime. Praise God. There comes a time you must speak like a prodigal son. No, like the four lepers, assess the situation. What benefits were you receiving from where you are coming from? You find there was nothing. Many times I slept in trenches. Many times I slept hungry. Many times I walked without a shoe. I came to learn that people put on a shoe when I came to Christ. I came to learn that people put on a tie when I came to Christ. I cannot return where I came from. There's four lepers, they say, if we go back where we came from, Samaria, there is famine. We will die there. Praise God. Then they looked where they were. They said, also, if we stay here, we die also. Let me tell you this one, and those who are listening to us, thank you for tuning in. The greatest mistake that you can ever do is to die without trying. Praise God. Somebody say, I won't die without trying. Somebody say again, I won't die without trying. In John chapter number 5, the reason why Jesus had mercy on this man is because the man said unto Jesus, while I am coming, while I am coming, the man was not just there waiting for the pool to be stirred up, but the man was trying to do something about the solution of his healing. And no matter how long it takes, so long as you are trying, God will give you a breakthrough. Somebody say, my breakthrough is coming. What are you doing about your situation? What are you doing about where you are? The Bible says the man told Jesus, why I am coming. He was not just there waiting, but he was trying. Then God looked and said, this man, he has tried enough. And that is why this man, they said, if we sit here, we die. Let us go to the Assyrian. If they kill us, at least even when our history is being written, it will not be written that we died in Samaria. Hallelujah. Even when our history is being written, it will not be written that we died in the place of the quarantine. But if the history is being written, it will be written that our people left Samaria. They crossed the quarantine, but they died in Assyria. Those were history breakers. And when they took risk, God manifested in them. I speak to somebody today that is watching us on this telecast. As you try to move from where you are, may the Lord give you a breakthrough. If you believe it, somebody shout in this house, amen. May God give you a breakthrough. I declare that in whatever you have been trying, the man at the pool of Bethesda, he was trying. Don't die without trying. Don't give up without trying. Because just because you fail, it doesn't mean that it is over. God is about to give you a breakthrough. God is about to give you divine connection. God is about to give you a miracle. God is about to give you divine opportunity. What the men they were going, they had no strength in the inside of them, but their mind was a fighter. They got no hand to fight, but inside their spirit they were fighters. They had no foot to walk on, but they were still limping. And the Bible says, when they got into the place of Assyria, surprisingly, I came to speak to somebody that God is saying, as you are trying, surprisingly, there will be a miracle. Surprisingly, there will be a breakthrough. Surprisingly, there will be divine favor. Don't give up in throwing out your net. Don't give up in trying to throw your net. You might throw it today. Nothing is coming back with it. Tomorrow still wake up. Throw the net again. You never know which day, which time will your net bring something. Somebody say amen. When I was growing up as a young man, I used to put a net, a trap for birds. So my friends, they used to laugh at me because their trap used to catch birds. Hallelujah. But mine, I will go and check and find there is nothing. Sometimes the birds could come and eat everything and leave the trap there. So I will go there every day and just put flour and leave it. One day, I remember it was a rainy season. I just decided, I did not feel like going, but I just decided, let me just pass by my trap and check. When I went into the trap, I heard something flapping wings. I heard something. Then when I moved closer to the trap, I found a dove was caught inside the trap. I pulled it out. I broke its legs. I broke its feathers. And I went into the house and roasted it. What am I trying to say? You never know which day your trap is going to catch something. Even if others are laughing at you, they are buying cars. Even if others are laughing
at you, they are getting married. Even if others are laughing at you, they are getting job opportunities. Some, they speak as if they own the office and the store of God. Wherever they talk in your presence, they talk in a mocking way. I came to let you know, God has sent me to come and let you know, it might be a rainy day like it was for me, but I came to let you know, surprisingly, there is a dove in your trap. Something has been caught up. Something has been found. Don't give up being a fighter. Fight until something happens.
Somebody say, I'm a fighter. Shout again, I'm a fighter. I can't hear you say again, I'm a fighter. That's why you must come to a place whereby you fight your way out of what is limiting you. Fight it. And that's why you want, do you want to get to the top? Fight. Somebody say, I will fight. Somebody say, I will fight. Somebody say, I will fight. Paul, how old are you? 20. I started working at the age of 15. At the age of 16, I was feeding my brother, who is your uncle, who follows me. I was feeding your auntie, who is following my brother. I was feeding your uncle, who is the last born. So every evening after school, your uncle could come to the market so that I can give him a tin of flour and give him some food so that they can go home and cook. At the age of 17, I paid your uncle school fees. And do you want to know how I paid it? Your uncle was in Form 4. So I was called at school that your brother is doing very well. We're about to go to the exam, but we cannot accommodate him because he has not yet cleared school fees. So I told the principal, I don't have anything. The only thing that I have is my mkokoteni. The principal said, now you have started talking. Somebody say amen. The principal told me, now you have started talking. So I asked him, what can we do? He told me that if we give you a job, can you do for us? I said yes. So long as it will be debited at the school as the school fees of my brother. They told me that there is a tree that has been cut in the forest 10 kilometers away from here. And we have cut the tree down because it is the firewood for the kitchen of the teacher so that they can be using it to cook. I told them I can use my mkokoteni to transfer the firewood. So I gave them the quotation. I gave him 500 per trip. Somebody say amen. When I got into the forest, I got a whole log of trees. A whole log of tree had been split into pieces. I started carrying one trip per day. So per day, I was doing 5 trips. 5 times 10, 5 times 500, that is how much? 2,500. So when I do 5 trips per day, they will write a voucher, then put it in a file. They will write a voucher, put it in a file. I did how many trips? I did 40 trips. 40 trips in 20 days. Praise the Lord. 40 trips in 20 days. So when they did a calculation, it reached a total of 50,000 shillings. And I was given a receipt. I had paid my brother's school fees and he cleared to go for exam. And he passed very well when he went for the university college here in Muranga. Also, I had still to come out in because by then our dad had passed on. Our mom was not there. Praise the Lord. You must carry on a spirit of a fighter. I have fought my way out. I'm not where I am because somebody helped me. I am not. In fact, let me tell you, if you ask me very well, who is your God Papa? How did you get into this city? I cannot even explain. Some of the opportunities and the doors that I have in my life, nobody can lay a claim and say that it is me that made this man. There's nothing that has come in his way. There are places I've gone, slept in trenches, slept in people's houses, slept in lodgings, slept in guest houses. But because I'm a fighter, God has made me to be where you are. Let me tell you, my children, you must be willing to fight. The person that is listening us today, don't wait. There's nothing that will come before you just because you want it. Be a fighter. Somebody say, I'm going to fight. If you don't fight, nothing will fit into you. Anything that you are going to fit into, you must be willing to fight against resistance. Somebody say, amen. And that is why if you want to go to the top, fight. Fight. That's why do not dodge battles. First battles. Somebody say, I'm going to first battles. First them and first them out. Somebody say again, I'm going to first battles. That now wants to first you, first it and finish it. First those battles. First those family member battles. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, the Bible says, no temptation has come to you which is not common to man, but God is faithful, who will not let you be tempted beyond that which you are able to bear. Face that battle and God will show you a way. Somebody say amen. Number three, you must be a risk taker. You cannot become a dreamer if you don't become a risk taker. There are people who are risk takers in business. Some, they will leave this country, they will go to South Africa. Some, they will leave this country, they will go to Sudan. Some, they will leave this country, they will go to Somalia. Not because they are looking for anything. They are looking for money. People risk because of money. You must be a risk taker. And that is why there is no rising without a risk. And no breakthrough or no reach without a risk. Faith is a risk. And that is why Mordecai took a risk. Esther chapter 3 verse number 2. Esther broke the passion law in Esther chapter 4 verse number 10. She said, if I die, let me die. Moses took a risk in Exodus chapter 5 verse number 12. Daniel took a risk in Daniel chapter 1 verse number 12. Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, they took a risk. They challenged the king. They said, O king, we are not careful to answer about this matter. If our God does not save us, then let it be. But if he saves us, it is fine. But we are not going to bow down to your God. They took a risk. You must become a risk taker. Don't be a victim of fear. Somebody say amen. Fear means false evidence that appears real. Don't let fear control you. If you are going to the top, you have to take a risk. Take a risk. And if you want your dream to become a reality, be willing to become a risk taker. Somebody say amen. Number four, you must invest in people. Any dream that you want to become a reality, God sends people your way. And that's why when you live for yourself, you live like a slave. Invest people. Find out good people that God sends into your life. I have shown you few of my friends. Praise God. I don't bring anybody here, but I've shown you few of my friends. And I've told you that this one, if something happens to me, run to him. If this one, something happens, run to him. Because you must know the good, the right friends that God has sent into your life. Not every friend is supposed to be of your formation. You must invest in people. When you raise people, they will also in turn raise you when you are weak. If you really caught in fire, someone else will also set up on fire. In Genesis chapter 14, verse number 14, the Bible says, the men that Abraham saved his brother with were those ones that he had trained in his house. So invest in people. Praise God. The degree to which you train people is the degree in which you will reign in life. To invest in people is to harvest influence in the future. David in 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse number 2, the Bible says that he picked up men that were discouraged, men that had lost hope, men that knew they were going nowhere. But in 2 Samuel chapter number 23, verse 8, the Bible says these were the men who were raised up by David. They fought and they killed the four giants from Goliath's house. The people that you raise are the people that will raise you. Somebody say amen. Amen. If you want your dream to become a reality, you must, number six, you must maintain passion. Number five, you must maintain passion for the kingdom. When you love the things of God, don't be a kind of a person that is pushed to serve God. Praise God. Yeah. You see, let me tell you, you will not go to heaven because your father was a pastor. Hello? You will not go to heaven because your father was preaching for other people. You have to develop a lifestyle that you love God in season and out of season. And that is why, show me a man who does not care about the cause of God on the earth, and I will show you a God who does not care about such a man. If somebody does not care about the things of God, does not care. God also is partial. Let me tell you, God is a partial God. Especially when it comes to his things, his mercy is for everyone. But when it comes to care, God only cares about those who care about his kingdom. And that's why your favor for God's kingdom will command God's favor in your life. Your passion for God affects your emotion in your life. Your passion for God also affects your portion of your life. Your passion for God determines your position on the earth. In Psalms chapter number 35, verse number 27, the Bible says that those who care about the cause of you, O Lord, they shall prosper in the land of the living. If you want to prosper, just take care of the cause of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. Number six is you must have confidence in God. You must have confidence in God. You just have to put your confidence in God. Then last but not least, you must put service ahead of your status. Service is very important. If you want to be great, if you want the Lord to bless your life, if you want to be lifted, if you want God to make you become a voice among other people, if you want to become outstanding among the standing, service. Jesus said, he who wants to be great among you, let him be a servant of you all. Let us rise up and offer it. I just want us to open up our mouth and pray today. Father, we give you glory. We bless you for today. We thank you for this opportunity you have given us. We are in your presence, oh God. We pray that, oh God, make every dream become a reality. I pray that, oh God, let every dreamer, don't let them, my Father, give up on the way. I pray what they have been carrying over years, it will not die in the name of Jesus. I speak a blessing. I release divine influence. I release divine connection in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray today, oh God, Father, release your blessing. Rendevo sikala bakaya. Belelebo sendele bera korobo sata. Yakabo sendele bera karabazetele bese. Rakabo sendele bezaya. Balala bosiki bakura bakotolonoze. Ratibo sendele bezaya. Father, we give you the praise. We bless you, Lord. We pray that, oh God, have mercy upon us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we give you the glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, I speak divine connection. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Thank you. I want to pray today. There are seven things that I've spoken about. The things that will make your dream become a reality. The first one, I said you must connect to the Father's blessing. Maybe you don't have a father. Maybe you're praying that God will connect you to a man that carries the heart of God. May that one happen in Jesus' name. Number two, I've said you must be a fighter. Nothing comes without a fight. Number three, you must be a risk taker. Number four, invest in people. Number five, maintain passion. Number six, you must have confidence in God. And number seven, you must put service first. If we want to be great in the kingdom of God, we must serve one another. Father, we thank you. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. Everybody that is watching us today, we pray that to bless them. We speak a blessing over their lives. We speak our divine connection. We decree let their lives be open. Lord, we thank you. We give you the glory. We pray that whatever the enemy had closed, let it be opened. I release divine blessings. We speak a divine opportunity. Lord, we give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let's believe and pray. Father, we thank you. We give you the glory for what you have done to us today. I speak a blessing upon us. And I pray today, Lord, my Father, you will continue to do greatness. Let your anointing be manifested in our lives in a way that you have never seen before. I want to pray that, Lord, my Father God, you will make each and everyone's dream come to pass. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse number 4, you say that before we were born, you ordained us as prophets. Lord, this is a dream that you have given each one of us. No matter where we are coming from, no matter which background we are coming from, each one of us has got a dream. And I pray that this dream will not die, but let it become a reality. I release my viewer with a blessing today. I speak a favor over their sacrifice and their offering. Lord, I speak a blessing. Hola, Basa. Maybe you have got an offering. You have got an offering and you want to give to the Lord. There is a number on your screen. 0721-548-45. Also, for those who are outside the country, you can use the details on your screen. You can either use Cash App, Wave, or any other means. And that offering, we are going to comfortably have it. So I want to pray for your offering as you connect to this service through your giving, that God will greatly bless you. Father, we thank you for those who are giving to you. I pray that you bless them. I speak a blessing over them. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We will see you at exactly 8 p.m. today. We are still going on with dealing with the toxic relationships. And I'm looking forward to have a great time with you at 8 p.m. Let us come and learn. These things are going to help you. They are going to help you. They are going to give you direction in whatever you are doing so that you do not find yourself a victim. God bless you. Have a great weekend, a great Sunday. Amen. Thank you.